Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Romance of American Communism by Vivian Gornick, narrated by Randye, Kaye. Let us acquit ourselves so that we shall not perish without having truly existed. The worst thing that could happen to us would be to die without either succeeding or understanding. Simone Weil. Introduction. One summer night in the early 60s, at a rally in New York City, the Cold War liberal Murray Kempton admitted to an audience full of old Reds that while America had not been kind to them, it had been lucky to have them. My mother was in the audience that night and said when she came home, "America was fortunate to have had the communists here. They, more than most, prodded the country into becoming the democracy it always said it was." I was surprised by the gentleness in her voice. She'd always been a hot-under-the-collar socialist, but then again, it was the 60s, and by then, she was really tired. The Communist Party USA was formed in 1919, 2 years after the Russian Revolution. Over the next 40 years, it grew steadily from a membership roll of 2,000 or 3,000 to, at the height of its influence in the 1930s and 40s, 75,000. All in all, nearly a million Americans were communists at one time or another. While it is true that the majority joined the Communist Party in those years because they were members of the hard-pressed working class, Garment District Jews, West Virginia miners, California fruit pickers, it was even truer that many more in the educated middle class, teachers, scientists, writers, joined because, for them too, the party was possessed of a moral authority that lent concrete shape to a sense of social injustice made urgent by the Great Depression and the Second World War. Most American communists never set foot in party headquarters, nor laid eyes on a central committee member, nor were privy to internal party policy-making sessions. But every rank and filer knew that party unionists were crucial to the rise of industrial labor in this country, that it was mainly party lawyers who defended blacks in the Deep South, that party organizers lived, worked, and sometimes died with miners in Appalachia, farm workers in California, steel workers in Pittsburgh. On a day-to-day basis, through its passion for structure and the eloquence of its rhetoric, the party made itself feel real and familiar, not only to its own members, but to the immensely larger world then existent of sympathizers and fellow travelers. It had built a remarkable network of regional sections and local branches, schools and publications, organizations that addressed large homegrown miseries, the International Workers' Order, the National Negro Congress, the unemployment councils, and an in-your-face daily newspaper that liberals as well as radicals regularly read. As one old Red put it, whenever some new world catastrophe announced itself throughout the Depression and World War II, the Daily Worker sold out in minutes. It is perhaps hard to understand now, but at that time, in this place, the Marxist vision of world solidarity as translated by the Communist Party induced in the most ordinary of men and women a sense of one's own humanity that made life feel large. Large and clarified. It was to this inner clarity that so many became not only attached but addicted. While under its influence, no reward of life, neither love nor fame nor wealth, could compete. At the same time, it was this very all-in-allness of world and self that, all too often, made of the communists true believers who could not face up to the police state corruption at the heart of their faith, even when a 10-year-old could see that a double game was being played. The CPUSA was a dues-paying member of the Comintern, the international communist organization run from Moscow, and as such, it was accountable to the Soviets, who intimidated communist parties around the world into adopting policies, both domestic and foreign, that most often served the needs of the Soviet Union rather than those of the Comintern's member countries. As a result, the CPUSA turned itself inside out time and again to accommodate what American communists saw as the one and only socialist country in the world they were required to support at all costs. This unyielding devotion to Soviet Russia allowed American communists to deceive themselves repeatedly throughout the 30s and 40s and much of the 50s as the Soviet Union rolled over Eastern Europe and became steadily more totalitarian, its actual life ever more hidden and its demands ever more self-serving. In the early 50s, the CPUSA came under serious fire from the wild panic over American security that McCarthyism set in motion. Scores of communists went underground out of fear of prison and perhaps worse. But then in 1956, the party very nearly disintegrated under the weight of its own world-shattering scandal. In February of that year, Nikita Khrushchev addressed the 20th Congress of the Soviet Communist Party and revealed to the world the incalculable horror of Stalin's rule. That address brought with it political devastation for the organized left around the world. Within weeks of its delivery, 30,000 people quit the CPUSA, and within the year, the party was, as it had been in its 1919 beginnings, a small sect on the American political map. I grew up in a left-wing home where the Daily Worker was read. Worker politics, global and local, was discussed at the dinner table, and progressives of every type regularly came and went. It never occurred to me to think of these people as revolutionaries. Never once did I have the impression that anyone around me wanted to see the government overthrown by violence. On the contrary, I saw them as working to see socialism become the norm through a change in the law, a change that would ensure that, with the defeat of capitalism, the American democracy would keep its broken promise of equality for all. In short, however naive that may have been, I saw the progressives always as honest dissenters. When I graduated from City College in the late 50s, I went west to UC Berkeley to pursue a graduate degree in English literature. For the first time, I met Americans en masse. Until then, all I'd ever known were urban Jews and Irish or Italian Catholics, mostly of immigrant origin. Now I discovered that America was a natively Protestant country, which meant that here in Berkeley, I met people from Vermont and Nebraska and Idaho, every one of whom had remarkably good manners and thought of communists as the nameless, faceless evil from across the sea. "Your parents were communists?" one after another said to me. No one seemed ever to have laid eyes on one. The shock to my nervous system was profound. It made me both defensive and aggressive, and in time I began finding excuses to announce myself as a red diaper baby wherever and whenever I could, exactly as I would have announced my Jewishness in the presence of open anti-Semitism. Most often, the red diaper declaration made people stare at me as if I were a curiosity, but there were times when the listener shrank viscerally. Decades later, I seemed not to have gotten over the experience of all those educated people characterizing the women and men among whom I'd grown up as somehow other. Once in a while, it flashed through my mind that I should write a book. By this time, I'm now speaking of the mid-70s, I had been working at the Village Voice for some years and had become a liberationist writer on the barricades for radical feminism. Everywhere I looked in those years, I saw discrimination against women, and every piece I wrote was influenced by what I saw. That was the easy part. Soon enough, however, and this was the difficult part, the women's movement itself began to spout a separatist line that contained strong suggestions regarding what was proper and what improper for a card-carrying feminist to say or do. In no time at all, those suggestions became imperatives. One afternoon at a meeting in Boston, I stood up in the audience to urge my sisters to give up man-hating. It wasn't men, I said, we needed to condemn. It was the culture at large. A woman on the stage pointed an accusing finger at me and called out, "You're an intellectual and a revisionist." "You're an intellectual and a revisionist." I hadn't heard those words since childhood. Overnight, it seemed, the politically correct and the politically incorrect were upon us, and the speed with which ideology developed into dogma made me reel. It was then that my sympathies for the communists reawakened, and I felt new respect for the ordinary, everyday communist, who, on a daily basis, must have felt repeatedly subdued by dogma. My God, I remember thinking, I'm living through what they lived through. For the second time, I thought of writing a book, an oral history of ordinary American communists that would serve as an inspired piece of sociology about the relationship between ideology and the individual, showing clearly how the universal hunger for a large life is inscribed in the relationship, and how destructive of that hunger it is when ideology is overtaken by dogma. I did write the book, and I wrote it badly. The problem was that by the time I set out to write what became The Romance of American Communism, I was indeed romantically, that is, defensively, attached to the strong memories of the progressives of my youth. To conceive of the experience of having been a communist as a romance was, I thought and still think, legitimate. To write about it romantically was not. Romantically ensured that the complexity of my subjects' lives would not be explored. There would be no presentation of the branch leader who loved humanity yet ruthlessly sacrificed one comrade after another to party rigidities. Or equally, the section head who could quote Marx reverentially by the hour, then call for the expulsion of a CP member who had served watermelon at a party. Or, worse yet, much worse yet, the party organizer who forced some directive originating in the Soviet Union on a local labor union when clearly that directive meant a betrayal of its membership. As a writer, I knew full well that the reader's sympathy could be engaged only by laying out as honestly as possible all the contradictions of character or behavior that a situation exposed, but I routinely forgot what I knew. I read the book today and I am dismayed by much of the writing. Its emotionalism is so thick you can cut it with a knife. The same rhetorical qualifiers, powerfully, profoundly, deeply, at the very core of his being, disfigure thousands of sentences. Then again, although the book is not long, it is strangely overwritten. Where one word would do, three are sure to appear. Where two sentences tell the story, four, five, six clutter the page, and every one of my subjects is either beautiful or handsome, while all are well-spoken and a remarkable number come out sounding heroic. The book was attacked by the intellectual heavyweights on the left and on the right. Irving Howe wrote a vitriolic review that sent me to bed for a week. He hated, hated, hated the book. And so did Theodore Draper. He vilified it twice. And so did Hilton Kramer. And so did Ronald Radosh. Because these men felt free to mount such an aggressive attack, I was persuaded that I had brought it on myself through the weaknesses in the writing. Of course, they were all violent anti-communists and would have hated the story I was telling if Shakespeare had written it. But it was incredibly naive of me not to have realized that all the Cold War animosities were as alive in 1978 as they'd been in 1938. What was not naive was to have considered the life of an American communist worth recording. And indeed, the stories that the communists tell here are still vivid, their experience still moving, and they themselves indisputably present. As I encounter once again in this book, the women and men among whom I grew, they and their moment come vibrantly to life. I am startled by all that I ignored, charmed by all that I captured, but either way, it seems to me that the communists mattered when I wrote about them, and they matter still. The one thing I do not regret is having written of them as though they were all handsome or beautiful, all well-spoken, and many heroic, because they were, and this is why they were. There's a certain kind of cultural hero, the artist, the scientist, the thinker, who is often characterized as one who lives for the work. Family, friends, moral obligations be damned, the work comes first. The reason the work comes first, in the case of the artist, the scientist, the thinker, is that its practice makes flare into bright life a sense of inner expressiveness that is incomparable. To feel not simply alive but expressive is to feel as though one has reached center. That conviction of centeredness irradiates the mind, heart, and spirit like nothing else. Many, if not most, of the communists who felt destined for a life of serious radicalism experienced themselves in exactly the same way. Their lives, too, impassioned by an ideal of social justice, were irradiated by a kind of expressiveness that made them feel brilliantly centered. This centeredness glowed in the dark. It was what made them beautiful, well-spoken, and often heroic. Whatever my shortcomings as an oral historian, and they are many, it seems to me that the Romance of American Communism remains emblematic of a richly extended moment in the history of American politics, a moment that, regrettably enough, speaks directly to our own, since the problems on which the CP focused, racial injustice, economic inequality, the rights of minorities, all remain unsolved to this day. Today, the idea of socialism is peculiarly alive, especially among young people in the United States, in a way it has not been for decades. Yet today, there is no existing model in the world of a socialist society to which a young radical can hitch a star, or a truly international organization to which she or he can pledge allegiance. Socialists today must build their own unaffiliated version of how to achieve a more just world from the bottom up. It is my hope that Romance, telling the story of how it was done some 60 or 70 years ago, can act as a guide to those similarly stirred today. Vivian Gornick, New York City, 2019. Chapter 1. To begin with. Before I knew that I was Jewish or a girl, I knew that I was a member of the working class. At a time when I had not yet grasped the significance of the fact that in my house English was a second language, or that I wore dresses while my brother wore pants, I knew, and I knew it was important to know, that Papa worked hard all day long. One of my strongest memories of early childhood is that no matter what we were doing, my mother and I, everything in our Bronx apartment stopped dead at 4:30 in the afternoon, and she began cooking supper. If ever I questioned this practice or complained or demanded that we continue what we were doing, my mother, whose manner was generally frantic and uncontrolled, would answer with a sudden dignity that stopped me cold. Papa works hard all day long. When he comes home, his supper must be on the table. Papa works hard all day long. Those words in my mother's mouth spoke volumes, and from the age of reason on, I absorbed their complex message. The words stirred in me, almost from the first time I heard them, an extraordinary resonance, one whose range was wide enough to compel my emotional attention throughout my subsequent life. To begin with, the words communicated pain and difficulty. My childish heart ached for my gentle father. The pain was frightening, and even as it began to flow inside me, like a liquid turning to a solid, I felt myself go numb. This emotion was awesome. It induced in me the sense of some mysterious force working on our lives, some force in which we were all caught, suspended, puzzled, moving, blind. At the very same time, the mere articulation of the words in my mother's mouth produced a peculiar and relieving focus against the murkiness of that mysterious force, a focus which told me where and who I was. I was the daughter of Papa, who worked hard all day long. Finally, the words said, "We are all of us, here in this house, vitally connected to the fact that Papa works hard all day long. We pay attention to and respect that fact. We make common cause with it." This last, this oneness, this solidarity produced in me pride and excitement. It dissolved the numbness and transformed the pain back into a moving, stirring, agitating element, something to be understood and responded to, something to be dealt with and struggled against. My father stood upright on the floor of a dress factory on West 35th Street in New York City with a steam iron in his hand for 30 years. My uncles owned the factory. My father was labor, my uncles were capital. My father was a socialist, my uncles were Zionists. Therefore, labor was socialism and capital was nationalism. These equations were mother's milk to me, absorbed through flesh and bone almost before consciousness. Concomitantly, I knew also, and again as though osmotically, who in this world were friends, who enemies, who neutrals. Friends were all those who thought like us, working-class socialists, the people whom my parents called progressives. All others were them, and them were either engaged enemies like my uncles or passive neutrals like some of our neighbors. Years later, the us and them of my life would become Jews and Gentiles, and still later, women and men. But for all of my growing up years, us and them were socialists and non-socialists, the politically enlightened and the politically unenlightened, those who were struggling for a better world and those who, like moral slugs, moved blind and unresponsive through this vast inequity that was our life under capitalism. Those, in short, who had class consciousness, and those lumpen or bourgeois who did not. This world of us was, of course, a many-layered one. I was 13 or 14 years old before I consciously understood the complex sociology of the progressive planet, understood that at the center of the globe stood those who were full-time organizing members of the Communist Party. At the outermost periphery stood those who were called sympathizers, and at various points in between stood those who held Communist Party membership cards and those who were called fellow travelers. In those early childhood years, these distinctions did not exist for me. Much less did I grasp that within this sociology, my parents were merely fellow travelers. The people who came to our house with the Daily Worker or the Yiddish newspaper Der Freiheit under their arms, the people at the affairs we attended, the people at the shul, the Yiddish school I was sent to after my public school day was over, the people at the rallies we went to and the May Day parades we marched in, the people who belonged to the various clubs and were interminably collecting money for the latest cause or defense fund, they were all as one to me. They were simply our people. Of a Saturday morning, the doorbell in our Bronx apartment would ring. My father would open the door, and standing there would be Jaime, a cutter in my father's shop, a small, thin man with gnarled hands and the face of an anxious bulldog. "No, Louis," Jaime would say to my father, "did you see the papers this morning? Did you see? A black year on all of them, what they're saying about the Soviet Union this morning?" "Come in, Jaime, come in," my father would reply. "Have a cup of coffee. We'll discuss it." I did not know that there was a difference between Jaime, who was also only a fellow traveler, and my cousins David and Selena, who were YCLers, or my Uncle Sam, who was always off at a meeting, or Benny Grossman from across the street, who had suddenly disappeared from the neighborhood. Unavailable was the word for what Benny had become, but it would be 20 years before I realized that was the word. It was, to begin with, all one country to me, one world, and the major characteristic of that world as I perceived it was this. At the wooden table in our kitchen, there were always gathered men named Max and Jaime, and women named Masha and Goldie. Their hands were work-blackened, their eyes intelligent and anxious, their voices loud and insistent. They drank tea, ate black bread and herring, and talked issues. Endlessly, they talked issues. I sat on the kitchen bench beside my father, nestled in the crook of his arm, and I listened, wide-eyed, to the talk. Oh, that talk, that passionate, transforming talk. I understood nothing of what they were saying, but I was excited beyond words by the richness of their rhetoric, the intensity of their arguments, the urgency and longing behind that hot river of words that came ceaselessly pouring out of all of them. Something important was happening here, I always felt, something that had to do with understanding things. And to understand things, I already knew, was the most exciting, the most important thing in life. It was characteristic of that world that during those hours at the kitchen table with my father and his socialist friends, I didn't know we were poor. I didn't know that in those places beyond the streets of my neighborhood, we were without power, position, material, or social existence. I only knew that tea and black bread were the most delicious food and drink in the world, that political talk filled the room with a terrible excitement and a richness of expectation, that here in the kitchen I felt the same electric thrill I felt when Ruben, my Yiddish teacher, pressed my upper arm between two bony fingers and, his eyes shining behind thick glasses, said to me, "Ideas, Dolly, ideas. Without them, life is nothing. With them, life is everything." Sometimes I would slip off the bench and catch my mother somewhere between the stove and the table. She was forever bringing something to the table. I would point to one or another at the table and whisper to her, "Who is this one? Who is that one?" My mother would reply in Yiddish, "He is a writer. She is a poet. He is a thinker." "Oh," I would nod, perfectly satisfied with these identifications, and return to my place on the bench. He, of course, drove a bakery truck. She was a sewing machine operator. That other one over there was a plumber, and the one next to him stood pressing dresses all day long beside my father. But Ruben was right. Ideas were everything. So powerful was the life inside their minds that sitting there, drinking tea and talking issues, these people ceased to be what they objectively were, immigrant Jews, disenfranchised workers, and indeed, they became thinkers, writers, poets. Every one of them read the Daily Worker, the Freiheit, and the New York Times religiously each morning. Every one of them had an opinion on everything he or she read. Every one of them was forever pushing, pulling, yanking, mauling those opinions into shape within the framework of a single question. The question was, is it good for the workers? That river of words was continually flowing toward an ocean called Verstand, within whose elusive depths lay the answer to this question. They were voyagers on that river, these plumbers, pressers, and sewing machine operators. Disciplined voyagers with a course to steer, a destination to arrive at. When one of them yelled at another, as one of them regularly did, "Idiot, what has that to do with anything? Use your brains. God gave you brains, yes or no?" "Well, use them." He was, in effect, saying, Where will that question take us? Nowhere. Get back on course. We're going somewhere, aren't we? Well then, let's go there. They took with them on this journey not only their own narrow, impoverished experience, but a set of abstractions as well. Abstractions with the power to transform. When these people sat down at the kitchen table to talk, politics sat down with them. Ideas sat down with them above all. History sat down with them. They spoke and thought within a context that had world-making properties. This context lifted them out of the nameless, faceless obscurity of the soul into which they had been born and gave them, for the first time in their lives, a sense of rights as well as of obligations. They had rights because they now knew who and what they were. They were not simply the disinherited of the earth. They were proletarians. They were not a people without a history. They had the Russian Revolution. They were not without a civilizing worldview. They had Marxism. With such a context, the people at my father's kitchen table could place themselves, and if they could place themselves, compelling insight, they could become themselves. For in order to become, one must first have some civilizing referent, some social boundary, some idea of nationhood. These people had no external nationhood. Nothing in the cultures they had left, or the one to which they had come, had given them anything but a humiliating sense of outsidedness. The only nationhood to which they had attained was the nationhood inside their heads, the nationhood of the international working class. And indeed, a nation it was, complete with a sense of family, culture, religion, social mores, political institutions. The people in that kitchen had remade the family in the image of workers all over the world, political institutions in the image of the Communist Party, social mores in the image of Marxist allegiance, religion in the image of the new socialized man, utopia in the image of the Soviet Union. They sat at the kitchen table and they felt themselves linked up to America, Russia, Europe, the world. Their people were everywhere. Their power was the revolution around the corner, their empire a better world. To see themselves as part of an identifiable mass of human beings with a place and a destiny in the scheme of civilized life, when until now they had felt only the dread isolation that is the inevitable legacy of powerlessness, was suddenly to see themselves. Thus, paradoxically, the more each one identified himself or herself with the working class movement, the more each one came individually alive, the more each one acknowledged his or her condition as one of binding connectedness, the more each one pushed back the darkness and experienced the life within. In this sense, that kitchen ceased to be a room in a shabby tenement apartment in the Bronx and became, for all intents and purposes, the center of the world, as that center has ever been described since the time of the ancient Greeks. For, here in the turmoil and excitation of their urgent talk, the men and women at the kitchen table were involved in nothing less than an act of self-creation, the creation of the self through increased consciousness. The instrument of consciousness for them was Marx. Marx and the Communist Party and World Socialism. Marx was their Socrates. The party was their Plato. World Socialism, their Athens. There are few things in life to equal the power and joy of experiencing oneself. Rousseau said there is nothing in life but the experiencing of oneself. Gorky said he loved his friends because in their presence he felt himself. How important it is, he wrote, how glorious it is to feel oneself. Indeed, how impossible it is not to love ardently those people, that atmosphere, those events and ideas in whose presence one feels the life within oneself stirring. How impossible, in fact, not to feel passionately in the presence of such stirrings. For the people among whom I grew, this intensity of feeling was transmitted through Marxism as interpreted by the Communist Party. At the indisputable center of the progressive world stood the Communist Party. It was the party whose awesome structure harnessed that inchoate emotion which, with the force of a tidal wave, drove millions of people around the globe toward Marxism. It was the party whose moral authority gave shape and substance to an abstraction, thereby making of it a powerful human experience. It was the party that brought to astonishing life the kind of comradeship that makes swell in men and women the deepest sense of their own humanness, allowing them to love themselves through the act of loving each other. For of this party it could rightly be said, as Richard Wright in his bitterest moment did nonetheless say, there was no agency in the world so capable of making men feel the earth and the people upon it as the Communist Party. Who came out of that world could fail to remember the extraordinary quality these experiences embodied for all those living through them? You were, if you were there, in the presence of one of the most amazing of humanizing processes, that process whereby one emerges by merging, whereby one experiences oneself through an idea of the self beyond the self, and one becomes free, whole, and separate through the mysterious agency of a disciplining context. In short, you were in the presence of the socializing emotion, that emotion whose operating force is such that men and women feel themselves not through that which composes their own unique individual selves, but rather through that which composes the shared, irreducible self. To all this, the Communist Party spoke. From all this, it drew its formidable strength. I was 20 years old in April of 1956 when Khrushchev addressed the 20th Congress of the Soviet Union and revealed to the world the incalculable despair of Stalin's rule. I say revealed because Khrushchev's report compelled millions of people to know consciously that which many of them had known subconsciously for a very long time. The 20th Congress report brought with it political devastation for the organized left wing. Coming as it did in the midst of one of the most repressive periods in American history, a period when communists were hunted like criminals, suffered trial and imprisonment, endured social isolation and loss of work, had their professional lives destroyed, and, in the case of the Rosenbergs, were put to death, the Khrushchev Report was the final instrument of annihilation for the American left. Thousands of men and women in the left walked about feeling as Ignazio Salone 25 years before them had felt, like someone who has had a tremendous blow on the head and keeps on his feet, walking, talking, gesticulating, but without fully realizing what has happened. And like Salone, they too said to themselves, for this? Have we sunk to this? Those who are dead, those who are dying in prison, have sacrificed themselves for this? The vagabond, lonely, perilous lives that we ourselves are leading, strangers in our own countries, is it all for this? Overnight, the effective life of the Communist Party in this country came to an end. Within weeks of the report's publication, 30,000 people left the party. Within a year, the party was, as it had been in its 1919 beginnings, a small sect off the American political map. For me, at 20, the Khrushchev Report snapped the last thread in a fabric of belief that was already worn to near disintegration. In the previous 3 or 4 years, I had often been in a state of dismay as I felt the weight of simplistic socialist explanation pressing upon my growing inner life. At 15, I had been a member of the Labor Youth League, the party's last incarnation of the Young Communist League, attending meetings in a loft on New York's Prince Street, where the walls were covered with huge poster pictures of Lenin, Stalin, and, who could now believe it, Mao, and where the party organizer came weekly to deliver exhortations and assignments in a language that increasingly began to sound foreign to my ears, remote, very remote from the language of the kitchen, which itself was beginning to be replaced by the language of Melville, Mann, Wolfe, and Dostoevsky now sounding within me. As my interior language altered and new kinds of thought challenged the once unquestioned, now vulnerable socialist ideology, shadows and confusions filled my mind. I began to feel a dreadful nagging pain developing at the edge of thought, sometimes like toothache, sometimes a sudden stab of fear, sometimes a quick wash of panic about the progressive world. Its logic began to break down, injustices began to loom, discrepancies in behavior nagged at me, questions arose for which there were no longer ready answers. I found myself arguing with my relatives and my father's friends. The arguments produced anger and divisions instead of explanations and unity. It was no longer sufficient to be told, "The party knows what it's doing," or "Do you know better than the Soviet Union what is good for the workers?" Or "They know better than we do what's going on. If they do thus and so, there's a very good reason for it. Who are you to question those in a position to know what's going on?" Now, in 1956, we sat in the kitchen, my mother, my aunt, and I. My brother was married and long gone from the house, not to mention the progressive world. My father was dead, and so was my Uncle Sam. We alone remained, we three women, in this crumbling house, to face the crumbling world outside the kitchen. Our men, our race, our politics, dead and dying, lost and gone, smashed and murdered. Hitler had destroyed half of our world, now Stalin had destroyed the other half. I was beside myself with youthful rage. My mother was desperately confused. My aunt remained adamantly Stalinist. Night after night, we quarreled violently. "Lies," I screamed at my aunt, "lies and treachery and murder. A maniac has been sitting there in Moscow. A maniac has been sitting there in the name of socialism, in the name of socialism. And all of you, all these years, have undone yourselves over and over again in the service of this maniac. Millions of Russians have been destroyed. Millions of communists have betrayed themselves and each other." "A red-baiter," my aunt yelled back. "A lousy little red-baiter you've become. Louis Gornick must be turning over in his grave that his daughter has become a red-baiter." And we stared at each other, each of us trapped in her own anguish. I, in the grip of that pain and fury that I can feel to this day, waking suddenly in the night now, 20 years later, having just read or heard some new report of inhumanity from the Soviet Union, I often find myself very nearly saying out loud, "All this done in the name of socialism, in the name of socialism." And she, my aunt, her strong peasant face, ashen with grief and survival, the world inside her and all around her dissolving in a horror of confusion too great to bear, too annihilating to take in. And all the while, in the back of my head, even as my aunt and I were turning and turning, locked together inside this waking nightmare of human disintegration, I was hearing the felt sound of Ignazio Silone's voice saying, "The truth is this. The day I left the Communist Party was a very sad one for me. It was like a day of deep mourning, the mourning I felt for my lost youth. And I come from a district where mourning is worn longer than elsewhere." All this happened a generation ago in a small world. An atypical world, many say, the ingrown world of the New York working class left. Certainly, it is true that this world never was duplicated with any exactness anywhere else in the American left. However, so far from being atypical, it was, in fact, archetypal. What was happening in all its striking narrowness and intensity in that kitchen in the Bronx in the 40s and 50s was happening simultaneously in one form or another in thousands of places, not only in this country, but over much of the Western world. The grief and rage that my aunt and I shared was heavy with symbolic weight. Not hundreds, not thousands, but millions of people in this century had felt themselves both come to life and then to death through devotion to this ideology, this party. 20 years have passed since the time and the atmosphere I am remembering dominated not only my life, but the life of the country. During that time, innumerable people have written unceasingly about the communist experience. Conservatives, radicals, ex-radicals, liberals, intellectuals, philosophers, historians, psychoanalysts, all have described, explained, defended, attacked, expanded, reduced, placed, and displaced the communist experience. And yet, whatever the elements were of that world in which I grew, whatever its deepest subterranean currents, only rarely do I glimpse them as I knew and felt them in the volumes and volumes that have sought to interpret the experience, and almost never do I see before me the flesh and blood people, or feel on the page the fierce emotional pull of that life, awesome, hungering, deeply moving, they all led. That life which accumulated into those large events, war, revolution, nationhood, foreign policy, realpolitik, which all those books are forever chronicling, that life that very nearly reverberated with metaphoric meaning. For beyond the literal need of my parents' socialism lay a larger need to which Marxism ever spoke and which the Communist Party ever embodied, the need within the human spirit to say no to the judgment of man upon man that is the politicalness of life. Nothing in the 20th century has spoken as compellingly, with such power and moral imagination, to this need as has communism. Nothing in modern times has so joined the need with the real and the ideal to produce a universe of internal experience as has communism. Nothing has so induced in men and women all over the world a commonly held dream of passionate proportion, one whose betrayal could never be forgiven, whose promise could never be relinquished, as has communism. It was this dream, this passion, this hook on the soul that made of communism the metaphoric experience that it was, causing people like my aunt to pass from vision to dogma, from exaltation to anguish, all the while remaining fixed in some truly terrible, truly awesome way on the object of the passionate dream. What I remember most deeply about the communists is their passion. It was passion that converted them, passion that held them, passion that lifted them up and then twisted them down. Each and every one of them experienced a kind of inner radiance, some intensity of illumination that tore at the soul. To know that radiance, to be lit from within, and then to lose it, to be thrown back, away from its light and heat, to know thereafter the ordinary grayness of life, black and lightness, that was to know a kind of exaltation and dread that can be understood only, perhaps, by those who have loved deeply and suffered the crippling loss of that love. The ancient Greeks defined sexual passion as a disease, something that strikes from without and touches a source of human need so deep, so hungering, that the rational and humane faculties are rendered helpless before the mad, distorting behavior that follows upon the attack, and are literally held in abeyance while the passion plays itself out, leaving the victim to recover as best he can. Homer's description of the love of Paris for Helen is confined within these terms. Helen touches in Paris his capacity for sexual love. Once touched, that capacity suddenly realizes itself as a hunger of the soul, expressive life is now given to that which might have remained inchoate forever. The hunger flares up in Paris and burns steadily within him. It is all light and heat of such a high order that it is as though all other forms of love he has ever known become dim and cold in memory. This light and heat are all-consuming. Paris is soon addicted, given over to the hungry need. In time, Helen herself, the object, the cause, the origin of the hungry, burning need, becomes less real than the need itself. The hunger now has a life of its own, a life filled with stubborn power. At this point, the nature of the force becomes clear. It is antisocial, fixed on itself, obeying internal laws that conflict with the laws of associativeness. In the face of such pressure, such driving human need, it becomes absurd almost to speak of Paris's intelligence, character, moral or psychological development. The pressure, quite simply, is there, powerful, prehistoric, filled with the grief and longing of the primeval soul. Beyond social time, beyond civilizing time, beyond tribal loyalties and the compassionate restraint of reason. There are, it seems to me, a number of stable hungers in the human psyche, each one capable of flaring into passion once brought to expressive life. One of these hungers, beyond question, is the need to live a life of meaning. The motive force is the dread fear that life is without meaning. This fear hunger speaks to a need not of the flesh, but of the spirit. A need having to do with the deepest definitions of what it is to be human. And as with other human needs, it is possible to live an entire lifetime without encountering the people, ideas, or events which will trigger into conscious life this primeval hunger. But once met. Marxism was, for those who became communists, what Helen was for Paris. Once encountered in the compelling persona of the Communist Party, the ideology set in motion the most intense longings, longings buried in the unknowing self, longings that pierced to the mysterious, vulnerable heart at the center of that incoherent life within us. Longings that had to do with the need to live a life of meaning. These longings haunted the communists, arising as they did out of one of the great human hungers, a hunger that finally had a life of its own, so that while at first the communists fed the hunger, at last the hunger fed off them. That hunger became, in short, a passion that was, in its very essence, both compellingly humanizing and then compellingly dehumanizing. For the law of passion is such that it is all, and when a thing becomes all, people do terrible things to themselves and to one another. Thus, among the communists, men and women who gained the courage to plunge after freedom were, in the end, not free. Men and women who had great intelligence were, in the end, in no position to use that intelligence. Men and women who were eminently reasonable and clung to the beauty and decency of reason were, in the end, a caricature of reason. Men and women who sought to control the cruelties of social relations through the justice of scientific analysis, in the end, used scientific analysis to impose new cruelties. And surrounding the whole of things was the longing. Responsible for the whole of things was the longing aroused by the vision of loveliness that was Marxism and could not be let go of, even when the vision became a trap, a prison, a shriveling of the soul, rather than the exultant enlarging of the soul it had been in its beginnings. Richard Wright captures perfectly the beauty, pain, and irony of the communist experience when, in his segment of The God That Failed, an extract of his book American Hunger, he describes the trial of Ross, a black comrade who has been brought up on charges by the Communist Party in Chicago in the 40s. The trial began in a quiet, informal manner. The comrades acted like a group of neighbors sitting in judgment upon one of their own kind who had stolen a chicken. Anybody could ask for and get the floor. There was absolute freedom of speech. Yet the meeting had an amazingly formal structure of its own, a structure that went as deep as the desire of men to live together. A member of the Central Committee of the Communist Party rose and gave a description of the world situation. He spoke without emotion and piled up hard facts. He painted a horrible but masterful picture of fascism's aggression in Germany, Italy, and Japan. I accepted the reason why the trial began in this manner. It was imperative that here be postulated against what or whom Ross's crimes had been committed. Therefore, there had to be established in the minds of all present a vivid picture of mankind under oppression. And it was a true picture. Perhaps no organization on earth, save the Communist Party, possessed so detailed a knowledge of how workers lived, for its source of information stemmed directly from the workers themselves. The next speaker discussed the role of the Soviet Union as the world's lone workers' state, how the Soviet Union was hemmed in by enemies, how the Soviet Union was trying to industrialize itself, what sacrifices it was making to help workers of the world to steer a path toward peace through the idea of collective security. The facts presented so far were as true as any facts could be in this uncertain world, yet not one word had been said of the accused, who sat listening like any other member. The time had not yet come to include him and his crimes in this picture of global struggle. An absolute had first to be established in the minds of the comrades so that they could measure the success or failure of their deeds by it. Finally, a speaker came forward and spoke of Chicago's South Side, its Negro population, their suffering and handicaps, linking all that also to the world struggle. Then still another speaker followed and described the tasks of the Communist Party of the South Side. At last, the world, the national, and the local pictures had been fused into one overwhelming drama of moral struggle in which everybody in the hall was participating. This presentation had lasted for more than 3 hours, but it had enthroned a new sense of reality in the hearts of those present, a sense of man on earth. With the exception of the church and its myths and legends, there was no agency in the world so capable of making men feel the earth and the people upon it as the Communist Party. Toward evening, the direct charges against Ross were made, not by the leaders of the party, but by Ross's friends, those who knew him best. It was crushing. Ross wilted. His emotions could not withstand the weight of the moral pressure. No one was terrorized into giving information against him. They gave it willingly, citing dates, conversations, scenes. The black mass of Ross's wrongdoing emerged slowly and irrefutably. The moment came for Ross to defend himself. I had been told that he had arranged for friends to testify in his behalf, but he called upon no one. He stood, trembling. He tried to talk, and his words would not come. The hall was as still as death. Guilt was written in every pore of his black skin. His hands shook. He held on to the edge of the table to keep on his feet. His personality, his sense of himself, had been obliterated. Yet he could not have been so humbled unless he had shared and accepted the vision that had crushed him, the common vision that bound us all together. "Comrades," he said in a low, charged voice, "I'm guilty of all the charges, all of them." His voice broke in a sob. No one prodded him. No one tortured him. No one threatened him. He was free to go out of the hall and never see another communist. But he did not want to. He could not. The vision of a communal world had sunk down into his soul, and it would never leave him until life left him. There is horror in what Wright has described, but there is glory in it as well. Here is no tale of alien and robotized creatures enslaved by mindless authoritarianism, no image of foreign betrayal and subhuman brainwashing. On the contrary, here is the portrait of a man who, in contact with a political vision, was made more human than he ever dreamed he could be, and it is the memory of that initial humanizing experience that fixes and holds him. What Ross cannot let go of is that moment when, through Marxism and the party, the vision of a communal world endowed his life with moral meaning. For in that moment, there quickened to conscious life in him the longing to give over his own isolation, to take the incomparable risk of shared existence. That moment touched naked need, an unconscious wound made suddenly conscious. Such a moment has visionary properties. It is one of profound self-recognition. And it is there, in that self-recognition, that the source of Ross's passion is fixed, that his exaltation and his dread are to be located. For Ross, the moment of self-recognition is inextricably bound up with Marxism and the party. The two have become welded together in his emotions. To lose one is of necessity to lose the other. The irony of the experience, of course, is that the visionary discovery of the self through the revelations of Marxism has ended in the dogmatic purging of the self through the authoritarianism of the party. Therein lies both the glory and the tragedy of the communist experience. It is the journey toward the vision that is brilliantly humanizing. It is the dogma at the end of the road that is soul-destroying. For 30 years now, people have been writing about the communists with an oppressive distance between themselves and their subject, a distance that often masquerades as objectivity, but in fact conveys only an emotional and intellectual atmosphere of otherness, as though something not quite recognizable, something vaguely non-human, was being described. This distance sets those being described, that is, the communists, apart from those doing the describing in such a manner as to imply that the observers would never have been guilty of what the observed are guilty of, as though they were infantile while we are mature, as though we would have known better while they were incapable of knowing better, as though we would have seen the writing on the wall while they, in their neediness, were constitutionally blind to the writing on the wall. In short, as though the communists were made of other, weaker, more inferior stuff, and what was in them is not in us. Ironically, some of the worst instances of this emotional distance are to be found in books written by ex-communists. Some small amount of this confessional literature is powerful and dimensional, such as the testimonials of Salone and Wright in The God That Failed. But most of it is either apologetic or self-castigating in tone. Whichever, it throws up a smokescreen between the experience and the reader. The self-accusation of the anti-communist communist is dismaying in the extreme. This is the kind of confessional written with a sarcastic defensiveness which so overwhelms the remembrance that what one is continually reading is what's written between the lines. Amazing! To this day, I don't know what on earth possessed me. This experience is as strange and exotic to me now as it must surely be to you. Look at what I was. Could you believe it? I can't. Perhaps the most complicated example of this kind of writing is to be found in Arthur Koestler's autobiography, Arrow in the Blue. In this book, Koestler details his 9 years in the Communist Party, discovery through conversion, through disillusion. Although he does indeed tell all, the good feelings, the bad, and attempts an objective rendering of the experience, still the language is such, the tone is such, that one feels of Koestler that, like Lady Macbeth, if he could scrape from his flesh, scald from his memory the entire experience, he would do so. His skin crawls over having been a communist. His syntax is surly, sarcastic, self-mocking, the words and phrases of one writing about the flowing past in the language of the self-censoring present. The language of one who, in effect, is saying to the reader, "I can taste the ashes, but I cannot recall the flame." Dozens of books of this sort have been written, both in this country and in Europe. But it is in the disinterested intellectual commentary of the past 30 years that that abstract and alienating distance from the communists is felt most fully. It is in the way a Lionel Trilling's language freezes over when writing about communists that one feels most the chill removal from the flesh and blood reality. Or a Richard Crossman, who writes of the convert to the Communist Party as though describing a creature who walks through one door a warm human individual and emerges through another a rubber-stamped robot. What is one to make of sentences like, "Once the renunciation has been made, the mind, instead of operating freely, becomes the servant of a higher and unquestioned purpose. To deny the truth is an act of service. This, of course, is why it is useless to discuss any particular aspect of politics with a communist." Everything in me rises up in protest against such language. This is the language of men who have assumed an intellectual opposition to the human falsifications inherent in the communist passion, and in the process are themselves committing human falsifications. Denouncing a monolithic political reality that is summed up in one armor-plated word, the word, of course, is Stalinism, they deny the teeming, contradictory life behind the word, and in so doing, deny the experience its complex human source. No, I always feel myself frowning when I read their words. It was not like that. It was not like that at all. It was not the monolithic experience you are here describing. It was rather a vast, sprawling, fragmented, intensely various experience whose complexity of detail adds up to a truth at variance with the sum of its parts. Yes, what you say is true, yet it does not amount to the truth. Yes, the passion was a formidable leveler, but oh, how many were the combinations of response to the power of that loved, hated passion. Yes, the loss of self was the truly terrible thing about communism, but oh, the hundreds and hundreds who fought daily, hourly, to hold on to themselves and still remain communists, and the wealth of human experience that is encompassed in that struggle. I see before me a schoolteacher who laughs and says, "The party was down on Freud, but in the Bronx we say, yeah, yeah, but your mother's important anyway." I see before me a labor organizer who walked a tightrope for nearly 20 years, years composed of daily decisions, daily arbitrations, in order not to betray his union members and still remain in the party. I see before me a section organizer who also daily disobeyed the party in order to serve his depression-ridden neighborhood. I hear the laughter and grit and self-mockery of countless people who spent a lifetime on the high-tension wire between being a communist with a small c and a communist with a capital C. Some of whom fell and were horribly broken. Some of whom fell, picked themselves up, and went further. Some of whom walked the wire successfully and remained whole and strong. All of this, this mass of human detail, this bulky human history, is lost in words like the convert to the Communist Party. Those words create an unbroken floor-to-ceiling image, a wall on one side of which we stand, on the other side of which they stand. Between us and them there is no vital relation. What is in us could never be in them. What is in them bears no resemblance to what is in us. We hold the life of the individual dear, they hold it cheap. We raise babies, they eat babies. We glory in the life of the mind. They put ideologic electrodes into the life of the mind. We walk straight and free and clear. They hide, hunched and shadowy at the ends of alleys. We learn, they brainwash. They are all always they. We are all always we. Ironically, this dissociativeness cultivated by the intellectual anti-communists is the very crime for which the party itself is hated and reviled. Theodore Draper's description of the making of a communist turns, ultimately, on human denial. Draper's superbly accumulating point about the communists is that the emotional identification with the working class, which made a man or a woman a communist, slowly became transformed into a binding identification with the party, which made a man or a woman a communist. This party identification reduced the ability of a communist to see himself in all those around him. Rather, he came to see himself only in the party. Thus, if a friend or even a relative fell afoul of the party, a communist was all too often capable of separating himself completely from that friend or relative. The person being charged, tried, or expelled suddenly became strangely unreal to the communist, not like the comrade he had only yesterday been, not recognizable, not like himself. And indeed, it was all too often too desperately true. How many times have I heard a communist say in reply to some question about this, that, or the other person he or she had known half a lifetime and who had been expelled from the party, "I felt disconnected from him. I felt that I was and always would be a good comrade, and he somehow was not." Yes, even though all those years he had seemed like a good comrade. Secretly, I felt that what was happening to him could never happen to me. It was this dread dissociativeness that disintegrated innumerable communists and isolated them in a disbelieving world. For this willed blindness is the diseased symptom of a vision become a dogma. It is the criminal part of passion. What, then, is to be made of those who scorn the passion, who declare themselves clear-headed and humane, and yet dissociate in exactly the same way as did those in the grip of the passion? What undeclared passion do they serve? What self-deceived disconnectedness is at work in them?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.